My name is Florida Kabasinga. I'm Rwandan, and I held various positions with the Office of the Prosecutor between 2003 and 2012. I was hired as a case manager and then an assistant appeals counsel, and finally I left at P4 level as an appeals counsel.
What was the ICTR like when you first started?
When I first started, ICTR was a very, very dynamic office. And I especially, I'm talking about the Office of the Prosecutor. You could see the energy in the office. You could see that people were clearly dedicated to the goal of providing justice, to finding the evidence, and to bring the best quality briefs. And I remember every Friday we had meetings where people exchanged ideas on how best to progress jurisprudence, what were the pressing matters in each of the cases, and senior trial attorneys presented the main points for each case. But every member of the team, whoever wanted to speak, was given an opportunity. So it was a very good opportunity for young lawyers like myself to learn from the seasoned attorneys.
What sort of challenges were in front of you when you were starting out?
When I arrived in 2003, it wasn't my first contact with the ICTR. As a student, I actually interviewed a lot of the ICTR staff for my thesis, for my undergrad. And I did my master's degree thesis on the ICTR as well, because of my background as a Rwandan. And I also did a 6-month internship before I actually ever came to do the work there. So when I arrived, actually everybody within the Office of the Prosecutor expected me to hit the ground running. I had the background, I spoke the language, so I could easily read the documents in Kinyarwanda, listen in to the audios and videos in Kinyarwanda, and I could speak to the witnesses in Kinyarwanda. So what was challenging to me actually was that there was too much work to be done. And within the Office of the Prosecutor, we had too few Rwandans who could do the kind of work that we were doing. So for me, that was the first challenge. And then as a case manager, I actually had so many files to handle at the same time. Luckily, they were all single accused cases, unlike some other case managers that had multiple accused cases.
Certainly, as a Rwandan, you were coming to the tribunal with a very different set of experiences and knowledge than lawyers that were coming in from other parts of the world. Did you feel like that was an advantage, or was it sometimes difficult to remain impartial and to not let certain emotional content kind of creep in to the work?
I would say it was a mixture of an advantage and a disadvantage. First of all, I wasn't in Rwanda in 1994. I was a student, a teenager in high school in Uganda at the time. But it impacted me a lot because I got to see the bodies that were floating down the rivers and lakes. And as well, my brother lost 5 children in the genocide. But as a teenager and a young person from Rwanda, what happened there actually spurred me on to become a lawyer. Because I decided from that point that justice needed to be done, but also in a court of law. That this, everybody who is suspected should go before a court of law, and if proved guilty, to be punished. But if found innocent, then that would be justice to me as well. So that is why literally all my career has revolved around the genocide, my legal career. And when I started work, because I focused on giving the best from myself, because it was a healing process, I wasn't affected emotionally in that way. And I realized that we were all in it as a team, as officers of the prosecutor. I think when you go into prosecution work, it's a calling, in my opinion. It's not that you go into it for any other reason, because you want to see justice done. But I remember because I wanted to see justice a lot within the team, if there was something that everybody was saying, we have enough evidence, or this case is 6-3, I always looked at all the evidence that we had and tried to persuade them that, look, this is individual criminal responsibility and we can actually get a conviction on it. We should also explore this. So this other avenue to see if there's more evidence that we can present. So in that way, I tried to take this beyond just a normal job. And I think on several occasions, a lot of my colleagues actually agreed with me because I was young. I didn't have any other responsibilities. So I could stay at the office longer and do all the research that was needed, go to the field more. And it didn't impact on any decisions that I did. As a case manager, I was very cordial and friendly with defense counsel. In fact, on several occasions in my own cases, defense counsel, I remember poignantly in the case of Carrera, defense counsel standing up in court and saying that there was a disclosure issue. And he said, don't worry, I'll sort it out with Florida. Because as a case manager, my door was always open. Because to me, if you're entitled to certain documents, the law entitles you to that, and justice entitles you to that, I would give them to you. So it was just about doing the best that you can as a prosecutor, but doing legal work and not emotional work. I separated my career with the emotions, just like anybody else who was working within the office of the prosecutor.
Why did you choose the ICTR as a place to turn your attention as a student?
It's because I wanted to contribute to justice. As a Rwandan, I knew it wasn't the first time that one ethnic group had been killed in Rwanda. I had heard about 1959, I had heard about 62, and I thought, look, going forward, this needs to be stopped, and it has to be stopped through justice and making sure that that suspected perpetrators are brought before courts of law. That's why I went, I came to work with the ICTR. That's why I did my research for my undergrad and my master's degree on the ICTR and the work of the ICTR, and then I came to work here. It was a healing process for me, and also seeing that the most key perpetrators were actually put on trial. For me, that was something that was good, not for me as a young Rwandan, because now I can look forward to the future knowing that the former leaders of Rwanda, of my country, that made mistakes are behind bars, and that future generations of Rwandans can learn a very good lesson from that, such that future leaders of Rwanda cannot think that they can do the same thing, that they can kill off an ethnic group and get away with it. That, I think, is a huge part of why I came to work for the ICTR.
What's it like for you going back to Rwanda now? Clearly, there's been a lot of cooperation between the ICTR and the Rwandan government, but there's also been a lot of issues that there's been very strong disagreements.
I think I went back to Rwanda at a time when the relationship between the ICTR and Rwanda had tremendously improved. There's been, in the past couple of years, a lot of cooperation between the countries, and you can see the relationship has much, much improved. But when I went back to Rwanda, it was the first time I was actually moving back to live in Rwanda, in my country. And so I got to Rwanda, and then now I work with the National Public Prosecution Authority as a legal advisor, advising on extraditions, seeking extraditions for fugitive suspects. So I'm actually continuing the work that ICTR was doing in Rwanda, which is, I think, is going to be my life's work, the genocide, and making sure that no single suspect stays free. They need to have their day in court, and if acquitted, then that's what the law says, they're innocent. And if they are found guilty, then they are punished by courts of law. I think at the end of the day, what evidence there is what comes before judges. And when they make decisions, they will be critiqued. Some will praise them. And at the end of the day, it's a court judgment. It has to be respected. So if they are found guilty, despite people saying that they have the evidence, what is known about what people did is completely different from evidence that proves beyond reasonable doubt that somebody did something. So as regards to whether they will be welcomed back home, I don't see why not, because in Rwanda you have hundreds of people that were acquitted or they've served their sentences and they're back home in their... I don't view these, the ones that were formerly with ICTR as accused persons, I don't see them as different from the ones living back in their communities in Rwanda. I don't. I honestly think they ought to consider going back home, because even the ones that are back home in the communities where they are suspected of having committed those crimes or the communities or for which the crimes they did, they were convicted for them or they confessed to those crimes, they are living side by side with the rest of the community without any problem. It's 21 years later. The wounds are not as raw as they were at the time, and there's been a lot of effort with regard to reconciliation. You have groups of victims that have come together with former convicts, and they're doing things in their communities. So I do not see why they cannot go back home and actually contribute to the country if they want to.
Looking back, were there any defining moments for you during your time at the STR? Anything that when you kind of survey your time there, that really stands out as being something that was a really important moment or an important case or an important conversation that you had that you'd like to recount?
There are two. There's one case that is very close to my heart that I would like to speak about, and also one defining moment for me. As a Rwandan who was working within the ICTR, I always found it strange that the interrogations in court of witnesses and everything was conducted in French and English. And because we had some prosecutors who are Rwandan, I decided one day to go to court before I examined a witness to speak in Rwanda. And I made a statement before I started interviewing this witness. I said, and it was in Kinyarwanda, and I said, I'm a prosecutor from Rwanda, and the gentleman who is accused in this courtroom is from my home area. He's from Kigali Rural, where my family originated from. And I said, he was the head of the prefecture, and I said, today is a poignant moment for me as a young Rwandan to be standing before you, and I'd like to interview this witness in my language. And I asked her a number of questions in Kinyarwanda, but because there was always simultaneous interpretation, it created a bit of confusion because the two of us were going back and forth, and it was not giving enough time to the interpreter, split into French and English. And Judge Eric Moses said, please, Madam Prosecutor, can you interview the witness in English in order to facilitate the process? Because Judge Moses was always pushing that the process needs to go faster, and this was going to delay the proceedings. But I think that was, for me, a very important moment in the history of the tribunal. Now, the case that most is very close to my heart is the case of Mikaeli Muhimana. He was a conseiller in Kibuye Prefecture, who was particularly extremely notorious for being so brutal, which is why he was tried at the ICTR. As a very small local officer, a local leader, he shouldn't have been a big fish that was prosecuted by ICTR. But because of atrociousness of what he did, he was brought to the ICTR. So he had raped a lot of women in Kibuye, and he had a neighbor, because he was a businessman and a conseiller at the same time. He had a shop, and he had a Tutsi neighbor who was also a businessman. And when the genocide started, he was hunting him down, and he was hunting a local policeman who was Tutsi, who was very well known in the area. So he eventually found the businessman and cut off his head and stuck it on the door of his shop and told the local population that he has come back to to buy your goods. And that head was stuck on that door until the end of the genocide, I think, because when we went back to Kibuye during the investigations, we actually found on the door a big mark on the door where the head had been. And with the policeman, when he eventually got him, he actually cut off his private parts and stuck them on an electric pole. So to me, this man was so brutal. I needed to see that all this evidence was brought before the court. And as a team, we worked extremely hard to do this. But we had 8 rape victims. And one of them was a Hutu woman who was raped by Muhimana. And then when one of the Interahamwe told Muhimana that you just raped a Hutu woman, he actually apologized to her. I said, I'm sorry, what were you doing with these Tutsi? So, you know, forgive me for doing that. And she came to court, and she was interviewed in court, they asked her, so do you forgive him? And he says, because Muhimana, the presiding judge was Judge Khalida Khan, who was a Muslim. So during the trial, Muhimana became Muslim somehow. He said, wearing the Muslim hat, I think he wanted to impress the judge. And then this young lady, when she was asked, did you forgive him? She just turned to him and said, I see now he's become Muslim. I hope the Muslim God forgives him, because I have a good life now. I have nothing to do with him. And that left a mark on me.